Another day dawns on the battle for Beyond. Another chance at a new life. Imagine being able to unmake your fate and forge it anew. Here at the end of time, anything is possible. For where entire worlds can be unmade, a life ill-lived is but a trifle. The realm of Polakot rests here, quivering at the end of time, full of potential energy that permeates the brave souls who have found themselves here, whether by sheer luck or determination. Some heroes come here to forge a legend that will last immortal in a place that crumbles into the sea of time with every waking hour. Others come for less noble reasons. I'm Jasmine, that bronze girl Bhullar, and it is my divine pleasure to welcome these stellar players to my table. Let's meet them now.
Hi, I'm Aabria Iyengar, playing Sestia, your Circle of Stars druid. I'm from the internet. I don't know what to say I'm from. Don't worry, Google me.
Hi, I'm Brennan Lee Mulligan. Google me if you like. It's, do whatever you feel. I'm playing Nikhil, who is a tiefling paladin warlock. Subclasses Hexblade, Oathbreaker. Ooh, hear the gravel in that voice. We're having a good time.
Hello, I'm Josephine McAdam, and I'm here. I made it here. I'm playing Merdina McConroy, who is a Triton fighter.
When I say I'm excited for this table, I'm not being sarcastic. This is like, I didn't know it was possible to like three people more until you got through your intros. And instead of being like, I'm here, this is a cool thing I do, you're just like, I'm here.
This is happening.
You can look if you want. I don't really care. I'm just here. So roll the fucking camera and the dice and let's get into it. I appreciate it. I don't know where that voice came from.
I like it. That's my character voice now.
You disembark a rail car that looks to be made of some strange metal alloy that somehow holds itself aloft between two rails that are made of a slightly different hued metal. It quivers gently between as it has finally come to a rest after what seems like a very, very long journey. This futuristic shape is something reminiscent of what you would see in an Art Deco gallery. It's formed of edges and curves and the sheer angles of the metal rather than any ornate scrollwork or other sort of embellishment. Here on the platform, we come across a porter, very carefully kind of stacking luggage one on top of another. You see her kind of humming and muttering to herself. She is a very shapely half-orc, the kind of lady that makes a whole tavern kind of turn and look the way she fills out her wrap skirt. She has a high neck, shiny black top and a matching skirt with an intricate magenta pattern that's embroidered into it. Her eyes are eager and her tusks are perpetually curved into a slight smile. Her hair is pulled up into a bubble ponytail adorned with geometrical silver jewelry. She looks across the people that are kind of pouring out of the train and her eyes fall upon a Triton. What does she see?
Well, she would see beautifully sculpted body of Merdina McConroy, who is, I think, about 6'7", a very lean blue skin with gold scales, sort of peppering her arms and calves. She is not wearing much, admittedly.
I wouldn't either if I looked like that.
Yeah!
She's got her clan sash going across. She's got some literal fishnet hanging on her hip. She's adorned with shells and pearls go through her very long, unkempt red mane of hair. There's braids, there's shells, there's pearls, there's... It's a bit of a mess, but it's still an attractive mess. And she would walk out confidently, always a little glance here and there, a wink. Very, very kind to
Roll persuasion with advantage.
Oh goodness! Wow, already.
Yeah, we're gonna pop this off.
Persuasion with advantage.
I love that description.
22.
She pushes the luggage that she was stacking up on one arm onto another porter and instead makes a beeline towards you, taking whatever bags you have out of your hand. She towers above you a bit because she is a very tall half-orc.
I appreciate it. I like it.
And she says, welcome. Sorry, common is not first language.
It's common for people to be tongue-tied around me, no matter the language, my dear.
I will take your bag.
Thank you.
But not to keep.
Well, I could always come get it later if that was the case.
Yes, I can. She kind of stammers a bit, and you're not sure if it's a language barrier or just the color rising into her cheeks at this point. She bites her lip a little, and whirling around, bumps into none other than Sestia, dropping some of the luggage. What does she see when she looks you up and down?
Sestia, like, took that straight to the dome because she's looking down. It's daytime, which is deeply uninteresting to her as someone who has spent her time studying the stars. So she's just sort of muttering to herself. She's tall, but not that tall, so about 6 feet tall, dark skin. She has, like, little constellations painted across her cheeks and this big oversized blue sweater. And she's kind of carrying everything that she has in, like, pouches and, like, with scrolls coming up and out, just sort of holding it in her hands up top and muttering under her breath in a language that if you spoke it, you knew was the sound of plants growing, of wind moving through grass, as she whispers to herself in Druidic to like get her nerves up. And she bumps and looks up and goes, hi, I'm sorry, I'm so sorry. Oh, that was my fault probably.
No, the fault was on my part.
I love your skirt.
I love you. Small nerdy child, come here to compete.
Small? I'm
the gods
so
bless you.
Tall. Thank you. Yes. I'm sorry, I wasn't listening to everything you said. Gods?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. That's good.
Well,
thank you.
Come Who follow me to the dorm. I'm Kishar. Yeah. I am your porter. And with this, she looks at you in the eyes. I am your porter.
Porter. Hi.
I will carry all your burdens.
Is everyone tall
till
here?
Death.
Oh,
wow. To hell.
That's...
To hell?
Yes.
That's very kind of
up
her.
For, oh my God, what have I gotten into?
And you as well.
Thank you. I don't want to go to hell.
Well, we don't have to go there today.
Ooh.
Sorry, common is second language. Translation is a little off.
Do you speak giant, draconic? And she just starts cycling through other
She
flavors.
Does speak a bit of elvish in addition to her own orcish.
Okay. Is it a little easier in elvish? Is
yes.
This okay?
Oh my gosh, hi. Yes. I feel like I'm a different person when I have to communicate with tourists. It's so hard.
I feel
hard.
The same way when I have to speak in languages that like people speak, and it's weird.
No idea how many times I've accidentally hit on someone. I think last week I might have accidentally married someone.
Happens more than you think.
Oh my
That's
gosh.
Okay.
Imagine walking up to someone whose bags are full and saying,
yeah,
can I carry your load? It doesn't exactly work.
You know what you did? You said it to me and I was like,
I know. It's horrible, but you know, you try.
Okay.
You do your best.
You're doing great.
You know what? Let me
do you
bring
want to hold
you down
something for you?
Here.
I'm sorry.
It's my job to hold things
for
you.
Yeah, I just want to be helpful because I don't want to die.
No
one's going to die.
All right. I have no idea what you're saying. I'm sorry.
I'm Sestia.
Oh, Sestia. And I'll take Cecilia's hand and kiss it gingerly.
She looks at you and says in Elvish, I want to put her in my pocket.
Same, just, but she's bigger.
Right? Just
yeah, I've got like a bag with a lot of room in it. Now it sounds like we're planning like a hostage thing, but maybe
No. Just, hi.
Hi.
Let me show you to your room.
That would be delightful.
Your first trial will involve a How do you say like a group effort?
A coordinated. Let me say it in common. It's going to be like it's a group effort. I don't know. I just said what you said.
So amazing, I'll take right? you yeah. to, but your third team member.
Wait, we're on the same team? Nice. No, that feels good for me.
Okay. And she starts leading you down the hall. There's ornate sort of mosaics kind of set into the marble flooring here. And as you leave the sort of like station that this rail is parked inside, the sky opens up above you and you see laid bare the cosmos. You see stars, rivers of them rolling through the sky, and you see shards, almost like pieces of glass of planets, of realms, all in different colors, different sort of biomes, topographies. And as you're gazing at this, you would notice this especially, Cestia, since this is your passion. You see like somewhere very like far in the distance, but close enough to make you uncomfortable, what looks to be a giant necrostar. And before your very eyes, you see a small, almost like island just go swirling into it and disappear.
Hey, can we just take like, I don't know, like a tight 30 to 2 hours for me to draw this in a
definitely
thing real quick?
Definitely no.
Okay, hold on. It's only going to take
prepare.
A minute.
You must prepare.
I pull out a scroll and start spreading it out on the ground and I just mm-hmm. start sketching what
it's
I see.
It's perfect.
I'll bend over if you need my back. And so
I move it onto
Redina,
her back.
It just like bends.
It's really flat. I expected more ridges, but you're stable, ma'am.
So what do you see up there?
Have you seen a star that like eats things? It's like a death omen. It's like that. That's what I see.
You see a death omen mm-hmm. in the sky.
You can see it?
Can you not?
Well, I am like looking for it, but a lot of people don't notice. You know, the sky is a bit dizzying here.
One of the reasons I wanted to be here, I've heard stories, I thought they were exaggerations. I study the skies, that's all I've ever done, and now I want to not focus on up there, but what's down here. But then it was cool up there, and I'm just gonna keep drawing. I should stop.
Some days I wish it could just fold itself down over me like a caramel blanket and just cease to exist.
I love you. I mean, same.
We should go because the awkward thing is, I was really rooting for you. You were supposed to be, and then she switches to common, team girl squad.
Girl squad.
Right.
But third yes. girl, smashed.
Ooh.
Like, yeah. In a fun right. party a bachelorette right. way or?
Too much yes. ale.
Yes. Beautiful elephant. Get victorious in her last battle. Chose to get very drunk. Now, probably not great combat partner. But we will find replacement. We will. Horrible replacement, but he will have to do.
Oh, it's not the girl squad
horrible.
Anymore.
Wait, what makes him so horrible?
Why is he?
Lecherous buffoon man.
Oh, lechery, okay. Buffoon, there's nothing I haven't seen before.
I've sent someone else to go get him, and right. he will join you in your quarters.
Wow, are we sharing quarters then?
Oh, are we sharing? The...
Yes.
Okay.
In the hero's repose, it's below the arena.
Oh. Okay, that's fine. This is gonna be great.
You can see the stars from there.
I'm not crying because I'm a strong warrior here for a tournament, but thank you.
Of course. And she very easily throws your trunks and bags over one arm and Whoa. Under another and okay. leads you into the arena. But now we're gonna look a little bit below the arena decks, past the hero's repose, into the kitchen. Where we find an individual peeling potatoes. Oh. What does he look like?
a beautiful tiefling man. And I, when I say beautiful, I mean fully mechanically with 20 charisma. He's leaned back, arms crossed behind his horned head, sort of incredible black feathery wings stretched out, sitting on the pile of sacks of potatoes. Tieflings have some sort of like demonic heritage, and this dude like clearly got an extra scoop. It's like tail, hooves, horns, glowing red eyes, tusks, and like full wings, which most tieflings don't have. Some tieflings are like my ancestor, and this guy's like maybe my dad. Like maybe like it's it's way way closer. Mm-hmm. Kicking it, he has hooves, so he can't wear shoes. But even if he did have feet, he wouldn't wear shoes as a point of principle and pride. Yeah. Because it's not the lifestyle he leads, man. He's trying to be relaxed. And is kicked back, smiling, and is peeling potatoes with a knife and a potato being levitated by the mage hand cantrip, just butchering ribbons of unusable potatoes, going, I'm doing a pretty good job. This is good potatoes, honestly.
As you're saying this, into the kitchen walks a figure very familiar to you. Light pink skin, long flowing hair that has been sort of, it's half up, half down. She has gold in her hair, claws long enough to skewer a man. And like I said, she's got the perfect blush pink. And she's wearing a long skirt that trails behind her, and a fitted crop top that's in the beautiful complementary color of turquoise. She comes in with a sort of bundle kind of tucked underneath her arm. And this is your sister, Malini. She kind of, like, as she comes in through the kitchen, she sees how you're posted up and just snorts and goes.
Something funny?
Your form needs a little bit of work.
Well, with my potato work? No, this is great. They asked for this. They said, we're tired, too much potato, too hard to cook. How do you cook it all the way through unless it's like this? So this is easy for me. This is like...
Did potatoes kill your family? Why would you do this to such a great vegetable?
First of all, I'm pretty sure potatoes are a type of meat. Second of all, they're not green.
They come from the ground, Nikhil.
Yes, so do birds or eggs or whatever. Look, I'm not going to have a potato argument with you right now.
They're warrior food, you know? Actually, this is why I feel like you're always disappointing me. You don't eat well, and therefore, if you're not eating well, how does your sometimes you've got your carb load. That's how you perform.
You're going to, okay. I don't know what happened in your day today. You're going to march in here and tell me about carbo loading, of all people. Look at this. It pull up. I'm shredded. Look at these abs. You get great cheese on these bad boys. You're gonna tell me about carbo loading? You're gonna tell me about health? You're gonna tell me about this? Why I'm down here, I'm an incredible warrior. And they got me in the basement peeling potatoes. Why? Because people say I'm not good to be around. Oh, he's a lecherous buffoon man. Says who? The people I've dated and then know me well? Relax. This is meat. Sorry I raised my voice. What's going on?
I came here with some good news.
What's the news?
Well, I think I might have a spot for you to compete.
Are you serious? Oh my God. Okay, 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 I'm ready. I'm gonna reach out and into my hand this long golden lance that in a whole visage of a dude that is projecting constantly how little he cares mm-hmm. about things mm-hmm. is the one thing he clearly cares about.
Yeah.
Grabs it, says, I'm good. We going right now? I'm ready.
Well, I'm going to introduce you. You have to play, it's a little bit embarrassing. You have to play in the group category to qualify. I know. I tried to get you a solo match, but they said that after the last time, they don't think, apparently something about you only lasted 8 seconds in the ring. I think I counted 10. I was rooting for you. But I did put my money on the other guy, so maybe I wasn't rooting that hard.
When you say hurtful stuff, I just want you to know that it just, that I'm so unshakable in how much I love myself and how great I think I am, that when these criticisms come to me, transfigured, you know? Everything you say about me is a reflection mm-hmm. of how you feel about yourself, because I am perfect. And as soon as all the people that I used to date realize that, less people in this town will talk shit about me.
You know, honestly, I think if we split the difference between my eternal self-loathing and how far your head is up your own ass, I think we could actually make a pair of great siblings.
Now I know you're lying, because my horns are way too big to get my head up my ass.
I've heard quite the contrary. But you know what? It's fine.
Okay, no, Selena, that was, first of all, we both said it was a bad idea, but that we should try it anyway. And I got pretty far. I'm incredibly limber.
If it wasn't for that cleric, I think we would have lost her. But we need to focus.
Okay.
Because I think you have a real shot this year.
Listen, look, all joking aside, I appreciate you pulling for me here, okay? Look, I can do this. Aren't you tired of these fucking interlopers coming in?
I am, they're outsiders.
Yeah, the whole—
one of us has to win some year.
The whole multiverse fucks up their life out in whatever they're doing and decides to traipse their way here to meet our gods and fix whatever they blew in their own universe. No way! No way! No thank you.
This is our time to shine.
I'm gonna win this for the family, and we are gonna have the glory, and then I will never peel a potato again. And everyone that ever made me peel a potato, I'm gonna—
we'd gouge out their eyes and kill their firstborn children.
That's exactly where I was going with that.
Slowly.
Slowly. They gotta know what's happening. The anticipation is half the fun.
I agree. Which is why I've already set about some of our machinations.
You have?
Well, one of the people who succeeded in a— you know that giant elephant cerebel?
Yeah.
Formidable warrior, the one with the Hanuman mace that just completely smashes people to death?
Yes.
I completely spiked her drink at the bar. And I was able to steal these. And she hands you a bundle of javelins.
Ooh. See, you always hurt my feelings, but then you pull through. And that's why we're siblings. That's not why we're siblings. It's actually reverse. We are siblings, and that's why we have this toxic relationship. Thank you for these javelins. Thank you for cheating. Because I also agree with that, both in this instance and in principle.
I know, this is why, once again, the whole thing with Serena, I know you believe in cheating, I'm well aware.
Listen, I'm not an asshole, all right? I'm just honest, all right? Everybody in the multiverse, if they were being honest, would always behave selfishly. And I'm convicted of that, and I've become bored with this conversation. And
I have become bored with the fact that you can speak out of your sphincter, but here we are. Let me take you up to the hero's quarters, the repose or whatever it's called, because it's probably going to be your only time ever being there. And if you botch this, I won't kill you. I love you. You're my brother.
I love you so much.
And she puts her hand to your cheek.
I give her a big hug. Mm-hmm. I give her a big, big hug.
Well, wow. I think you can do it.
I think I can.
And the only reason I'm hard on you is because I really want you to just go out there and show those Ferengis 1-2.
Both of the people up there as soon as we get upstairs.
Well, you have to beat the
Nikhil. Team, yes, sorry, I am listening to what you're saying.
Wait until after the challenge and then slit their
throats. After the challenge, kill the elephant, kill them both.
Not the elephant's already taken care of.
I didn't Nikhil. Listen, you talk so much!
Oh my god, and with this sort of raucousness happening, you see coming up the stairs, still arguing, two tieflings. One with red skin described as earlier, and the other pink with a turquoise outfit, deeply embroidered. Her eyes are large and doe-like with a small, cute mouth that has the most mischievous grin that you could ever muster. Heartbreaking and also very alarming. And she approaches your porter and says, okay, this is your third teammate, and I think your room is going to be the first on the right.
It is a pleasure. And an honor to meet you both. I'm Nikhil, and what an extraordinary adventure we're all about to go on together.
Oh,
Absolutely. Merdina McConroy and Hardy. Oh, you've got some strength there, sir.
Thank you. That's very kind. You seem a formidable warrior yourself. I think, by the way, you both described your characters as quite tall, right?
Yeah.
Yes, I...
You see, Mikhail sort of orients his chin down so that his horns pop up above you. Well, three equally tall warriors, and that's important. And it's a pleasure to meet you both.
There's the buffoon part. Are you a lecher?
Oh, and you see, he looks... What was the name of the porter again?
Ishii. I forgot. Oh, yes. That was what it was.
What was it?
Ishii.
Ah, I see you've been speaking to Kishar. Kishar, great to see you again.
She just stares at you.
Kishar was...
She's the half-orc.
Oh, no, yeah, Nikhil is looking at Kishar going, you're mad at me because of... This was cousin's wedding, or this was... Oh, I actually remember. Fair, and let's go inside.
She throws your bags on your bed. You find yourselves in a beautiful round room that has these like sort of circular windows looking out on, actually it's behind you because of this beautiful set. Circular windows looking out upon a sea of stars, hypnotic and scintillating. Around you, you see pieces of armor beautifully kind of like displayed and, She throws your bag on the floor. Her demeanor has changed, Kishar's demeanor, and she seems a lot more annoyed to be in this general presence. But she still gives you a warm look and says, if you need anything, I am yours.
Where do I find you?
Just ask anyone. She points to the other sort of like employees at this place.
I think she's moved on from you.
Right, I'll keep that in mind, and Radina also places a kiss, if Kishar allows her hand.
Yeah, you are too kind. And she, like, leaves. Then you see Malini decides to bid her farewells to you, and she, like, says, whispering in your ear, and she says, remember, wait for the right moment.
For sure. Right moment, too.
And then...
Right moment for what?
Can I roll to try to hear that?
Yes, roll perception.
I would love to be a part of this. Damn it. 14.
Let's roll to see how sneaky she is. Very, very sneaky. You hear them murmuring, but they're speaking in a language you don't understand.
Oh, that must have been what it was like when I was talking earlier. It's very rude, I'm so sorry.
Oh, it's fine. Most things people say goes over my head. Look.
Oh, you're so tall.
At this beautiful art you've got. It's moving. It's almost, I swear, it's almost like we're looking outside.
Well, that's my cue.
And she extends her forearm to you and says, we live forever.
As legends.
With a single downward stroke, she leaves.
Welcome to Policode. That's not art. That's what that really is. You're looking at that.
Yeah.
Oh, that's incredible. See, I spend a lot more time below decks, you might say. This is not enough time looking up, I think.
So what's your deal?
What's my deal?
Why? I heard you weren't supposed to, right? Didn't we have someone got smushed?
Yeah.
Smashed?
An elephant got smushed.
Yeah. Tremendous tragedy. It's very sad, but happy to be here, at least to give you all a fair shot to get into the tournament. You've traveled a long way to be here, presumably. Where are you both from?
I'm from the Adhara Plains. Scholars, mostly.
Oh, interesting. You come from a land of scholars?
Yeah. And we do a lot of... And you can see that, like, the entire time she is struggling to stay focused on you with the windows, like, right there. She's like, don't look over. I'm present.
You come from a land of scholars, and you decided to come to Policote to compete in the Rajmadan as a scholar?
No, I came to compete as a warrior. I can be both. You don't know me.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know I don't know you, so I'm asking questions.
Oh, yeah. Then yes.
Okay.
Don't underestimate me.
Okay.
Look forward to seeing you fight.
And how about yourself?
I hail from the Scatha Isles, far north from the seas. You may have heard of my people. We're great protectors of the depths below, mm-hmm. keeping a balance on all the watery depths.
I've read a book. Is it true what they say about...
It's all true.
The hell? Oh. What innuendo did she just accidentally stumble on?
Nothing, don't. It's fine, don't worry about it.
Those horns have been places, I can tell. You'll know soon enough.
Whoa. Listen, I know that Kishar probably told you that I'm a piece of shit.
That's because you are. And she's like coming back in, speaking in Elvish now.
He's a lot.
He is a lot.
I don't like him, I think.
Yeah, don't get comfortable.
He kind of smells like wet dirt. You know what I mean? Like an uncooked potato.
That's getting that vibe too.
Yeah, okay, it's not just me.
Do you know what they're saying?
I don't speak Elvish, so am I not able to understand this Elvish conversation?
No. You just see them both like casting side eyes at you while talking to each other.
I noticed you guys were flirting. Do you want to know?
Oh, have you?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, you think someone dislikes someone that much just for normal reasons? Like I cheated at, you know, bocce ball, and that's why I'm getting these dirty looks?
What language are you speaking?
Know. Common.
Yeah. Oh, are you speaking common?
Yeah.
As you say that, she turns and she says, "You just had to care for my fish for 1 week."
I did. I cared for the fish for 1 week.
It died.
I didn't know you meant... If you say 1 week, I think 1 week. If you say every day in the week, it should be every day.
I asked you for one thing.
I did. I went on a Saturday, and I was going to go back the next Saturday. And I got back, and the fish was already dead. And I am sorry.
I loved Pelodio.
Pelodio?
And he's dead because of him. He hates fish. She says this with meaning to you as though it's a nice thing to say.
Yeah.
So, first of all, I'm not a fish. That's just...
But him
that's insensitive.
But him and I...
It's all right. I'm willing to forgive. Let's put down the hand.
Okay.
No pillowing. None.
Pillowing?
Oh.
None.
Standing up, yeah.
Gotcha.
Just no pillowing. Killed my fish.
Well, that's downright fox there.
I didn't kill Pelodio. I didn't go in and shoot a spell at Pelodio.
No, did you just starve him to death? Have you ever been
starved? If Pelodio wanted it, he would have hopped out of the tank and flippity-flopped over to the field.
Water with beer!
Yeah.
Why would you do that?
He lives in a little cube! What does he eat? He can't have fun! Let him cut loose! He's a fish! He doesn't want to get fucked up one time?
That's unfortunate. I see why
she
hates you.
Five gold says that they bang before this is over.
Why? She's so beautiful and pretty and shimmery and has high cheekbones and beautiful red hair.
You gotta get in there if you're trying to... Whoa, that was a very detailed description. I'm saying if you're gonna get in there...
Her eyes glimmer like the deeps, and inside them I can see there lives a shark. A shark that desires my heart.
I start writing it down. That's really good. Keep going.
So do you work out?
No, I'm just like this.
You see her despair as she sees this interaction happen.
Yeah, I think I'm just like this. I eat, honestly, tons of potatoes. And this this just happened.
You do smell like potatoes.
I was cutting potatoes before I came here.
Why?
I love potatoes.
You want some potatoes?
I would love some potatoes. Did you bring some?
I can get you some potatoes if you want some potatoes.
Get in there.
Kishar.
I don't know.
I'm going to get my friend Merdina some potatoes. You want some potatoes?
No. You are going to the commemoration hall and then the armory to prepare for your battle.
I still want to know why you have access to potatoes.
Access to potatoes?
Because he
potatoes are under
is
lock
a
and key.
Kitchen hand.
I'm momentarily a member of
Hold
the
on.
Kitchen staff.
As a punishment.
Hold on, you came for me for being a scholar, but you're an up-jumped potato peeler.
You probably care about being a scholar, and I am a bad potato peeler. So, ipso facto.
Isn't that worse?
Wait, but as punishment for...
Yes.
A horny
beautiful
crab.
Star creature. Sapphire of the ocean.
Oh. That's so beautiful.
Yeah. You're too kind.
Sapphire.
Are you?
My eyes.
You can continue.
Strong like your cart from the bedrock below the deeps.
Oh, that's really good.
Everlasting and eternal, like the waves themselves.
I can't believe someone this thirsty is actually pulling ahead. That's amazing. This is unreal. That's I think the novelty's gonna wear off in a second, and Merdina's gonna clock that this is it's a good thing you're from the ocean, because this person wants a lot of water. Good grief.
I've got a lot to give.
All right, let's go to this hall.
You would begrudge the ocean. You've never gotten anything wet.
I've gotten, it's a good thing that I'm resistant to fire, because how hot it is, if it's wet when there's, yeah. I'm going to workshop
don't
that.
I'm going to grab your hand and
don't
go,
strain
on.
Yourself.
That's all right. You'll get there.
I'll
get
you
there
did your you. Best.
And she kind of like leads you to the armory doors. The armory doubles as a sort of locker room for the champions. You see gurneys coming in of warriors in different stages of disrepair, from a simple broken leg to others a little bit more worse for the wear. And you see a small goblin. This small goblin is stoop-shouldered with mutton chops. He has a bristly ponytail, and he gives off this aura of being much bigger than he is, all the way from the tops of his arched eyebrows down to his red lacquered hobnail boots. His widow peak kind of points at each of you in turn like a compass. And he says, I'm here to inspect your armor, make sure you're up to snuff and you don't get hurt out there. Now, at any point in time, you can yield, but that does mean you technically fail the challenge. Now, don't worry, you can still proceed. It's just, you know, more difficult to win. The further you fall in the rankings, I mean, you would know this, the harder it is to get up.
Hold on, why do you know?
I grew up here. I'm from here.
Have you ever competed in this before? I'm sorry, Goblin, please give me 5 more minutes to-
It's okay.
Thank you.
Go for it.
Have I competed in this before or no?
I don't know, have you? I think your sister mentioned that you've like sparred before.
Yeah.
It's completely up to you.
There's a lot of preliminary things that are not actually the Rajmadan proper. I've been in those, but we find that it's kind of hard for locals to get into the competition.
Why is that?
Well, there are...
it's a lack of resources, really, you know?
Doesn't seem right.
The
you
entire,
have a big stick? The I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, for sure. The entire town is set up like you're seeing, like, you know, you're arriving in a city where the doors open wide and you're ushered in and everything is set up to usher you to this place and welcome you in. Those pathways don't really extend into the actual city proper here. It's like a lot of town. I mean, you know, you're a scholar, right?
Mm.
If you've ever been in a town that has a giant academy or a university in it, does the university like go out of its way to make sure that life is good for the people that like live in the town?
Okay, I get where you're coming from and without implicating
myself. What are you saying? It's just proper.
No, I understand.
Just flocked. I mean, but it's not a horrible place to live. It's just, you know, there's a... Less ways for us to, well, most locals don't even want to compete because it just feels like that's tourist type of stuff.
Mm.
And there's other ways to be a part of glory and grandeur, and there's nothing wrong with the service of others, of being a part of someone else's hero's journey. It takes a lot of little support beams and struts to create a bridge. And most of us, you know, we want to be a part of that. So I don't begrudge my positioning at all. I didn't know you felt that way. Do you?
Oh, let me be very clear. I absolutely love living in this magical nexus of incredible arcane technology and having grown up in this place with all of these vast mystic resources bent to helping people from other places fix problems that they had. That's good, actually. That's good for me. And I like that.
By the way, Sestia wipes away a little tear that looks like a falling star while he was talking. It's just,
you're just being a downer now. This is your team.
It's extremely selfless of you.
Hey, thank you. And that's the thing about me, is that I'm very selfless.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah. Well, let's get a preliminary inspection going. Now, for most of you, except for the local, I'm guessing you found something that was your ticket here. Is it in good working order? Did you have the... It's like sometimes you don't know what it is, right? Like it's a key that looks like different things, you know? And there's a group out there right now, and like one of them's got like this really cool gauntlet that like casts light. Another one has like this giant stick that's like all black and creepy looking. You know, do you have like something that you were studying that helped bring you here? Like was like your pass allowed us to like answer the call, as it were?
Sestia takes like her arcane focus, this cool star shard, and tucks it into her sweater and then starts dumping out her bags and searching for something else.
Give me an intelligence check.
Haha. Joke's on you, I'm not that smart. let's see.
15.
You recall the journey it took to obtain your star shard amulet. And now, in fact, it almost seems like the last few days your journey here was a blur. You spent so much time chasing rumors and myths of this place, and all of them led you to one item. And when you found it there in that cave, placed so like precariously upon that plinth that was like kind of the breadth of a needle, almost as though it was suspended in space, the star shard. Almost like a sort of a piece of quartz or crystalline structure that within it contained what looked to be liquid cosmos. It bonded to your soul almost immediately.
All right, there's one more thing it could be, but let me be very clear. If I have to part with it for more than a minute, I'm gonna lose my fucking mind on everyone here. And she like reaches down and pulls out this really like long chain at the end, just that little sliver of star shard. She holds it up and you can see she's like wrapped the chain around her hand several times and pulled it out, but will not let it go.
It looks like it works. And what type of gear are we working with here?
Hold on. I just learned a new
thing. Kind of looks like you're just wearing a sweater.
Hold on. And she puts the shard back on and grabs it and kind of clenches. And through the armor, this like kind of jagged crystalline, like, or through the sweater, this jagged crystalline armor like pops out. So she still looks cozy with this giant blue cowl neck sweater, but there's just armor built into it.
Okay, he like takes out a hammer from his belt and taps on it twice. Yeah, no, that looks proper. Yeah, that'll pass muster.
She does like a full turnaround.
Have any knives, anything that needs sharpening? What about you? You're just a downright wreck, aren't you? No, actually, you maintain your spear well. Based off of your potato peeling, technique,
I really need to bring more heart to my potato peeling. That's what, I gotta double down.
A true artisan pours his heart into everything he does. I give the same care to sharpening kitchen knives that I do to maintaining your weapons.
And that's how you got this job as this guy in this room who does this thing you do.
That was really mean.
Nice.
This NPC isn't rude, Brennan. He can't retort.
Maybe, you don't want to get the fire. Don't pick a fight with the tiefling. I'll hellish rebuke your ass without a spell slot.
Yeah. You see, like, everyone observes this. You see Olin kind of like, that's his name, Olin Munn. You see him kind of like.
You want to tell me more about how to peel potatoes? Or you want to tell me my spear is good?
I'm just trying to prevent you from getting your potato peeled out there. Look at them. And he points out of one of these like windows that's kind of built like a dugout area, a small viewing deck. And you notice now you're actually below the arena and you can see up into it. The scene before you is a verdant tropical rainforest. You see what appears to be a cleric with long flowing hair and a long skirt being just completely drenched in fire. Next to her
is a like slighter figure with like black hair that's been pulled up into a bun, trying to shield her. And then away in the distance, or some distance back, behind an imposing scarred figure wearing a baby face mask, you see a tall, like sort of muscular, looks like a warrior, but as you're watching, you see him cast a spell and form a gauntlet in his hand. And before your eyes, he punches this man that's belching fire onto these two women in the, like, right in the bread maker, three times, four times, five times, six times, with insane speed, this giant magical gauntlet flashing every time. The baby face mask, the mask character, flies back and hits the floor with a sickening thud as the entire arena roars with cheering and laughter. The few warriors that are in this room with you are sitting on benches underneath this window that's looking up into the arena, and they start cheering as well. And he says, "That guy is gonna make chutney out of you. I'm just trying to help you, Nico. I'm on your team."
"Okay. Do you have stuff?"
"I'm trying to..."
"Help? What do you mean by help? You wanna help me? I'll take help."
"I'm just checking, do you need anything?"
"Yeah,
need
give me a full plate armor." "Yeah, I'll take full plate armor. I'll get one full plate armor to go."
"Okay. All right.
Just for real? Wait, are you being for real?"
"Yeah."
"Dude, I'm so sorry I raised my voice. That's great, and you're good at your job. And when I said the thing about potato peeling, I forget what I said to you. But whatever it was a joke or I didn't mean it."
Roll deception. Because I feel like you're lying. If you're not lying, let me know.
"Can I help by, I just want to give him advantage to be like, yeah, we've been joking the whole time we've been here.
Yeah.
That's how he's, and we're such good friends."
"Oh my God.
Thank you for helping me dodge that nat one. That's gonna be a 24.
Mm-hmm. "You know, Nicole, sometimes your words cut me so deep, but I've learned to realize that that's just because you've been cut so many times. That there's a large part of you that will never recover and never be able to live up to this image that you feel you have to be, but I want you to know you're perfect the way you are. So yes, I will get you that plate armor."
Nicol does get genuinely emotional here and says, "I know I'm a fucking clown. I appreciate you saying that."
"I know you didn't mean it."
"In your day, I'm probably the only guy or one of the few guys you give a hard time to. In my day, every person I meet, I'm one of the few guys they give a hard time to. So for me, it's everybody. So when I snap back at you, it's because I'm expecting it from every person I interact with. And I really appreciate you saying what you said. And I'm sorry that I said something hurtful."
He already believed what you had said earlier, but you saying it with this emotion pack behind it makes him shed the sort of veneer of professionalism he was holding on to. And he gives you his forearm and he says, "I don't know why you enter, but I hope one of us wins. It should be one of ours."
"To my two allies here, I can guarantee that it's been a long time since my last scrimmage, and it will be very exciting for the team of us to definitely get through this first round." I extend my hand.
He takes it.
"That was so nice. Can I have a sword?"
He goes and brings you a beautiful sword. He brings you, you rolled so well. He brings you a full plate set that is plus one.
"Do you believe in magic?"
is going to give you disadvantage on your stealth checks.
You might imagine Nicol is not the most
stealthy.
So discreet.
Yeah, it's going to give you some difficulty with maneuvering underwater, and, there's a bit of an encumbrance factor there. But the plate mail he brings you isn't like the more generally kind of... like, a lot of the plate mail here is made almost IKEA style. Like, it's meant to be as inoffensive as possible, to blend in with what you're wearing as much as possible. Mm. But the plate mail he brings to Nicol is one that you can tell he forged with a lot of love. much like the sort of like paisley pattern on his boots, he brings a plate mail that is also very thinly inscribed. In fact, you can only see it at certain angles. What color would it be, Nicole, to match what you have?
If it's possible for Olaman to really match this, it's very clear Nicole is like all about comfort and has never had armor, but it's also, I think there's something where like, you can tell his physical characteristics, my physical characteristics as Nicole are not high. He's not very strong. He's not very dexterous. He doesn't have very high constitution, but this like intense fiery, like the charisma is the core of his character. This like warlock spell casting. I think it looks like a dull red kind of matte plate armor that as I don it, the like glow from my eyes hits the joints and edges of the plates that light up with like a orange golden like ember glow that lights up the full plate.
Yeah, the intricate sort of engravings light up as you don the armor, and they glimmer for a moment. The filigree is beautiful and probably looks like my hands.
Let's go.
Yeah, it's adorned with flowers and things like that. It's beautiful.
Beautiful work, Olaman.
Did you make that?
Oh, yeah.
If I don't die out there, I would love to ask.
It's what I'm here for. And I think that breastplate, that looks like, it's got to be your bit.
Absolutely, it is. Look at that runework. Passing through, sent to me. And as Merdina puts her hand like to the chest plate, the scales of her arm sort of extend to meet it. Mm-hmm. And create like this golden armor, fabled armor of the Deep One, you might say.
Yeah. How long did it take you to find it? Did you take it here, eh?
Honestly, a lot of sailors come through our isles, and I'm a bit of an amateur brewer myself, and you get a certain amount of delicious, intoxicating liquid in these sailors' bodies. They just let slip a lot of information and sometimes lose some invaluable items along the way. This was one of them.
Well, I respect it. I love it. It looks absolutely stunning on you.
Thank you.
I don't think I could do anything for that, at least. It seems to be in perfect working condition. You have a blade, you need new arrows, javelins, anything I can get you up and running. Here's your sword.
Thank you. I'm ready. This is fine.
There you go.
Yeah.
Keep your wrists straight and just make sure you don't stick yourself with it.
Yeah. Allow me, I'll step behind. Yeah. And put my hands on Cestia's hands, wrap around, and want to.
She like leans back into it, completely losing any like warrior force.
So he just holds firmly. There you are, and just do movements, right? Yeah, no, you've got the feel of it, right?
I feel very safe. I mean, powerful right now.
Got a lot of strength in you, I can tell. Anyway, I'm gonna let go now, right?
If you have to.
You've got this. And
all right then. So we're gonna do this. We're gonna do this. This bit, right? Where you go battle.
Is there anything? Radina's going to pull out a giant ass claymore that's just been chilling on her back. This has been passed down generations, but it's just has never failed me. But I'd love to know if there's anything, Olaman, that you might bestow upon it.
Yeah, let's see, actually. He's never been asked this before. He looks at it carefully and, like, reaches for his tools at his belt, but then leaves them there. He says,
there's nothing I can give you that's more than the blessing of your people and those who've come before you. Heritage is it's the armor that protects all of us. That being said, I'm just interested in, well, maybe for another trial, for another day, you might find that you want to keep it just the way it is.
Noted. Thank you, wise one.
All right, it's my job to usher you to the hole. And you're gonna follow this hole all the way down. Nicola leads you. They'll lead you straight to the arena. I met some kids earlier today that I was really rooting for. But you're all just so precious that now I find myself torn between two of my faves, you know? I feel like I've got all these little favorites. Don't know what colors to don. But this next one, good luck. They brought somebody out of retirement that for this next challenge that, you know, just, I hope things go well out there.
Thank you.
Sure they will. Thank you.
I'm going to be very honorable in this moment and say that I cannot, that the strength requirement for full plate armor I do not meet, unless it is mithril, in which case it would ignore the strength requirement. But I wanted to check in because I don't want to be a cheater. Brennan, Nickel does. Brennan does not.
Yeah. We'll workshop something. It'll be fine.
You got it.
Yeah. I think we're going to break and then come back, and I'll workshop that.
Jasmine! Let's go! This is so good!
Every heroic journey has sacrifices. Every person has moments in their life where they have to make tough decisions.
It's intense. It's emotional.
Hard fights and bitter losses and stuff.
Something about making the decisions, right or wrong, good or bad.
So, how do you want to do this?
Walk through this hall shoulder to shoulder with the armorer standing in the sort of doorway to the players' sort of locker room and armory, kind of leaning against it a little wistfully, almost with an imaginary handkerchief, waving it for you. As you walk through this dark tunnel, the energy in the air is scintillating. You can hear the roaring of the crowd. You can feel it in your teeth, because this tunnel travels underneath these podiums that everyone's seated in. You can hear the stamping of their feet, the cheering, the merrymaking above you. And how do you feel?
I feel like this is what I was meant for. Feed from the cheers of others. Soon they'll be cheering my name.
I thought this was more of an abstract thing. I'm fine. This is fine.
Do you need a hand?
No, I'm fine. Thank you.
The doorway made of sunlight that is streaming inside, it's blinding because you're in the dark, is looming ahead of you, Cestia. With every step, it grows bigger and bigger and bigger. And you feel yourself becoming smaller and smaller and smaller.
She reaches a certain point where she feels so small that either she would collapse on herself, or she reaches that place that she's always studied the stars and has found peace in feeling dispersed into a universe that's infinitely big. And she reaches for that instead. And I think in that moment, she takes a step. And if you don't mind me activating an ability early, mm-hmm. I would like to use my wild-shaped starry form. And she steps forward and her form completely turns into stars. It's a humanoid outline that just looks like a galaxy walking. And I'm gonna roll my, well, you're supposed to do it during the long rest, but
it's okay.
It's even. And all you hear is this low rumble that reminds you of, or just, it feels like what the universe must sound like, all of those impossibly large objects turning. And she just says, wheel. And is like in the zone now and has like completely like ego obliteration. She's not there anymore. And whatever is here is ready to go.
All right.
As you say this and the sunlight bathes your astral form, the scene on the other side of this door is not what you expected. It's a beautiful glade with pieces of what looks to be ruined buildings kind of dotting the edge, but that's not what catches your eye. What catches your eye is a tree in the middle of it with wax bark. It branches out almost into the sky itself, almost blotting out the sun, casting a beautiful shade right underneath its boughs, and its leaves are a beautiful dark purple color. Nicole, as a local, give me a history check.
We're about to learn that even if you're from a place, you have to be paying attention. Nat 20, baby!
Let's go!
And that gives us a dirty 20.
Yes, that gives us a dirty 20, but the Nat 20 is a Nat 20. So this is the scene laid out before you. It seems calm, idyllic, and as Cestia's sort of like star form enters into it, it almost looks like a creation myth. You see this creature, this humanoid figure cloaked in stars, eyes like galaxies, piercing purple, walk into this glade of soft green grass. It's about knee height. It gently wafts in the breeze. There are broken stone ruins around you, this beautiful tree in the middle, and you are standing just at the edge of the extent of its shade. And as you're standing here taking in this, like, this sort of scene, the crowd around cheers as you make your entrance into the field. Then as though, well, not even as though, by magic, a giant magicron appears in the sky with the face of a dwarf. She has beautifully coiffed golden hair cascading over one shoulder. Her eyes are wide and curious with a touch of mischief, and her nose kind of like has that one of those permanent wrinkles from like being just a little bit judgy. Her voice booms across the stadium, and you can actually see just the vaguest hint of her from where you are. She's quite a distance away in a box that's kind of suspended almost in between these giant stands that are almost look like they're erected to the skies. There's just a dizzying sea of people around you. As she speaks, like, you hear her voice, like, just kind of almost get amplified in this giant coliseum. And she says, "Hello and welcome to our newest contest. Now, that last one was a doozy, but now we've got a brand new lineup with a newcomer to shake things up a bit. Now, can we get an introduction from one of our own?" And then, bloop, she pops up next to you, Nicole.
Do I know her name on that, you know, yes, that 20
you do.
History?
Yeah. Harpy Goldendale. And you'll get another piece of history from that as well.
Amazing.
Oh my.
Nikhil fully changes in this moment. "Well, Harpy, it's wonderful that you ask. How are we feeling, Policote?"
The crowd roars.
I take to the wing within this new gleaming armor, throw this golden lance on high. It says, "Hometown hero makes good!" And breathe a bunch of fire. I'm going to say, "It is an honor, nay, a privilege, nay, my destiny to introduce you to the Siren of the Stars, straight from the heart of the Academy. Give it up for Cestia!"
I immediately like take like three steps forward, and I want a druid craft to turn the grass under my feet like this dark starry blue. Ooh. That just sort of ripples out in a wave.
As you do that, like, Harpy comes skipping over to you, and you notice as she's skipping, it kind of like glitches for a second and then blinks in and out, and you realize it's a minor or major image.
Yeah.
Probably major. Major image. And she says, "You know what they say, folks? Blue is the color of this season, and you'll actually be able to get very special Cestia theme merch just from our gift shop, an exclusive only here on Polycoat. So make sure you go and check it out. The Lady of the Stars herself. Some say it's written in the stars, some say it's destiny. What is her secret? But that's not all. Although we have wonders from the stars, we also have wonders from the sea. What's your name?"
"I'm Merdina McConroy, and I can see we've got an amazing crowd with us tonight. Such beautiful faces looking down, and we hope to do you proud because we will win this. And that lady in the first row, I see you."
And I take out a shell and toss it into the crowd.
Give me a performance check.
Try to catch the shell.
I'm going
to try to catch the shell.
Give me a sleight of hand.
I kind of look at Ceci and be like, "Good God, this lady never quits. We're about to fight."
Oh my God.
16 performance.
Yeah. A single rose comes flying out of the stands towards you. And then another, and then another, and then another.
I only got a 3.
Yeah, it grows out of your hand, and it's actually Harpy who catches it.
By the way, just to let you know, you're not going to see any of that merch.
Really?
No.
Yeah, I don't remember signing anything about it before.
She kind of like saunters to the middle of the field, and she says, "Ah, but today our newcomers will be fighting a hometown hero.
Are we fighting
the likes of which they've probably never encountered before. This is one of our toughest challenges of the day, and we do wish them the best of luck, especially to our hometown hero, Nikhil. Hero isn't the word I'd use, but you know, at least you're ours."
We can talk later about it if you want to.
And she like poof, disappears.
Her too. She's gone.
I'm a mistake everyone's made, okay?
Respect.
So, Nikhil, you hear, well, you all hear it, but as the second contender you imagine is about to be introduced, you hear the crowd take up a call. And they just go, "Bzzz, bzzz, 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 bzzz."
Maybe I don't do the clap too.
Bzzz,
don't do it.
As you're doing it, the sound is actually like kind of disturbing in some ways. Yes. Like hearing an entire auditorium make this strange sound. With your 20, with your nat 20, it dawns on you that you are going to do battle with the swarm. A giant face almost form of a hive mind of what you could only describe as devil hornets. You're not sure where they came from, maybe the infernal plane. But Nikhil, with a 20, you would also know that these creatures became sort of local legends after they destroyed a horde of locusts that were attacking people's fields here in Polycote. And they've been heralded as heroes, welcomed, and for some reason now, you assume they're going to do battle with you. You recognize their tree. You don't know quite how it got here, but you recognize it from your childhood. And you recognize that these creatures are actually pretty kind to the general populace, but very great weapons against invasive species and therefore beloved amongst the people.
These guys absolutely suck. I hate these dudes. Everyone thinks they're so cool. Oh, they killed all the grasshoppers, locusts, whatever. It's like, I could kill a bunch of locusts.
What are their defenses? What are we up against?
Well, you know, they're nitty bitty, but there's a lot of them.
I see that.
They fly, so that sucks for me. But
like as a druid, I should not have a problem or have it.
They also are devil hornets, so they're, you know, I assume they're probably, I wouldn't use fire if that's a thing that you do.
They're of the devil.
Well, relax, you know. I'm also of that, so, you know,
that's
there's not a whole...
True, just a little bit.
Yeah, but I'm saying, you know, they don't do fire. I'm not trying to make a judgment. I'm not saying they don't suck because they're of the devil. They suck because they're fucking... like,
as
oh
you
my
make
God.
That face, yeah. A giant swarm emerges from the tree. As the crowd reaches fever pitch, you see people shrieking excitedly with this buzzing sound. And you see a face make it right back at you, formed of a multitude of hornets, forming two perfect, like, kind of recessed eyebrows and eyes. The mouth opens wide, and then it sticks out a tongue made of hornets and goes, and the crowd cheers. It goes wild.
I'm sorry. I keep.
Immature.
I keep.
Roll initiative. All right. Lay it on me.
Dirty 20.
18.
6.
I have two questions for you when you are ready that are about how the competition works. My first question is, do we, would I know, based either on the history check or just having grown up here, would I know if there are going to be other rounds today?
No.
There are not
this
going to
be
other
will be your last round.
This will be the last round today. Cool. Also, for me to clear, does my whole team have to clear?
No.
No.
You have to.
Do I feel the vibe that he's thinking about that?
I'll throw the deception down right now.
We can do an insight versus deception check, yeah. If you lose, you will go into the loser's bracket, or there may be some other consequences.
That's a 24 on my deception check.
Fine, fine. All right, we're doing this. Insight. Yeah, that would be a 25 to see your bullshit.
Oh,
I see the universe and you're a bad man.
Yeah.
So here's the deal. What you're going to want to do is this. You two should stay very bunched together. And
I want to reach forward with that starry form and just grab him by the front of his new thing.
Hey.
We win together.
You got it. And I agree, actually.
Just let him go.
All right, Nicole, you are faced with this swarm. Hovering just above the edges of the boughs of this beautiful tree. You get the first action. You get the jump on them. What do?
Incredible. Big ol' swarm o' bees. Here come the devil hornets.
Big
okay.
Swarm
o. Also, one last thing. Is there any, is Nikhil aware of like, obviously he's a narcissist, so he's gonna wanna interact with the crowd anyway. Mm-hmm. Is he aware that of anything going on with the crowd that actually has material benefit to his interactions in this space? Like, is gassing up the crowd good for us in some way?
Roll a perception check, I guess, yeah. See what you can notice.
Copy that. Zero, a dirty zero. I rolled a 2 and I get a minus 2.
The only thing that dawns on you is you wonder if, actually, no, with the 0, you don't even think of that. You're mad at them for choosing the bees. You're just angry.
You guys like these bees so much, huh? You guys like bees? Bees showed up. I'm from here. All of you can bite my ass. And I'm going to rush off, just sprint towards the bees. I hope the locusts come back! and sprint right at them. I'm gonna unload. We're gonna hex blades curse these bees.
Mm-hmm.
That's number one. And then I am, I'm gonna move. So tactically, I'm gonna go 2 spaces forward on the map. Boom, boom. Strike at the hornets from here. I'll make my attacks. Now,
How far away are you?
I'm 10 feet away, but I'm fighting with my lance.
Okay. They are like 10 feet up because they're in the lower boughs of like that branch.
Copy. Mm-hmm. They're 10 feet up and 10 feet away. In that case, I will take wing as I'm running to like rise to meet them.
Mm-hmm.
Start flying. I'll make these 2 attacks with the lance. Number one is only a 12 to hit.
That does not hit.
Question, does that feel close to hitting?
like visually, did I see a near miss or a full miss?
Go ahead and give me an insight check.
Sweet.
Actually, not an insight. Yeah, an insight into the monster, I guess.
Nice. Please be, goddamn, 13?
Let's see, actually, they're not, it's a swarm, it's not super deceptive. Yeah, you think like he just barely almost grazed them.
Sweet, then I would like to, as my reaction, use a point of my cosmic omen to add a d6.
Perfect.
Add 4.
So that would be a 16.
That does hit.
Hell yes.
And I would love if, just love if the blade just flashed like, just sort of like a galaxy for a second as you're swinging and it just corrects just a little bit as the universe from back.
It's almost like the lessons that Merdina gave you earlier. You just almost cosmically just touch his elbow a little bit and say,
you hear that song from Ghost just a little bit for a second.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hell yes. So in that case, I'm going to hit on one of those two attacks. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to go ahead and I'll throw a smite down on this as well.
Perfect.
So let's go, bam. I'm gonna listen to Sestia after she both threatened me and then made my attack hit that was gonna miss. So we won't be stingy, we'll throw a second level smite, which is gonna be 1d12 plus 4d8, oh no, sorry, 1d12 plus 3d8 plus 5.
You're about to murk a bee, I think.
Yeah.
Here we go.
That's at least two dead bees, right?
Three, bada boom. 22 plus 5 is 27 points of damage.
27 points of damage. As your, as your lance goes cleaving through, flashing with these spirals and galaxies as it does so, finding its mark, you do cleave through the middle of this face that has formed. As you tear through it, the face distorts and twists, and something happens.
Oh.
A good thing, a great thing.
Wonderful.
We did it. We're done.
We're done. We killed.
So happy.
Winners.
It's dead.
And I helped. Good night, everybody.
Splitting it into two smaller swarms where the two eyes once were.
Gotcha. Weird question, because I have my Hexblade's curse on them. Mm-hmm. Does it follow to one of the smaller ones or does it disappear? The one that winked at me, I'm like, don't make fun of me. have my hex blades.
So the far one.
The far one, yeah.
Perfect.
So after that attack, I'm gonna use my remaining movement to fly, and I had that reach on them, so I should be out. I don't know what their reach is, but I should be able to dodge the attack of opportunity. And I'm gonna fly back behind Merdina.
Perfect.
I'll go, ah! And then flap back and wait and do a cool three-point landing to disguise that I'm hiding behind Merdina.
Merdina, you see Nicole hiding behind you. It's your moment.
I've got you, don't worry.
Hey, thank you.
And I'll just go sprinting with my claymore above my head. For honor! And go and just slice.
Well, are they still up higher?
Yeah, they're about.
Would you allow me to do a jump and slice down?
Yeah, as long as you have the movement for it, which I think you do, one could reasonably assume you could, because
right,
I think you can jump
like
up to your,
close, right?
What is it, your strength modifier?
Yeah. Plus 4 feet, yeah, absolutely. There's a good jump calculator.
I always forget it.
I thought it was the score, no?
It's a jump calculator.
Yeah, your strength
score. Was it not the actual number?
Your strength score is 18. How tall is your character?
6'7", is that what I said?
Yeah, that's what I remember and have committed to my heart.
DMs, help, and DMs.
Yeah!
According to the Fex Labs jump calculator, your high jump is 7 feet off the ground.
Let's go. So you're about 3 feet short. Give me an athletics check.
All right.
Pro bono rules lawyer.
Athletics check. Let's go.
DMs helping DMs. Sliding into DMs. DMs.
I will also say this. With a running start, to what it's degree, I believe the thing that is 7 feet off the ground is your feet, which would mean that the top of your body would actually
be. So you're actually, you could strike 14 feet up.
Exactly.
Roughly.
Mm-hmm. It says you can reach up and grab something 16.8 feet off the ground.
Yeah, so in that case, just go ahead and roll the hit.
Woo!
I'm so amazing. Glad we sorted that out.
Amazing.
Quite frankly, I'm blown away by your ability to find tools to make easy the labor of dungeon mastering.
You got it. Thanks, Fex Labs.
Well, it's only an 11 to hit. Presuming that misses.
It does miss. You misjudge the distance just a little bit, and as the swarm also sees you like running and jumping, and it just dodges under your blade and then reforms again.
I'm gonna play it off like that was just part of my sweeping like power up to the second swing. And standing, can I jump back up? Is that a how much movement?
I would say you're still in the air because you have to remember like 1 minute
Okay, so I'm just doing some
10 rounds of combat.
You've got time.
This is all happening within seconds.
Okay, second attack. Well, it's a 16.
A 16 does hit.
I would like to expend a superiority die.
Yes.
To do a sweeping attack.
Perfect.
So I need to spend that. And I will add, so I can deal damage to another creature within 5 feet of the original target within my reach if the original attack would hit it, equal to the number I roll on the superiority die.
The second swarm is a little ways away.
Oh, see, I was, I was thinking there was like multiple within the swarm or something.
No, it's
just one. Well, then.
So it's like a little homebrew thing I did where, the swarm is like just easier to keep combat flowing that way.
Totally fine.
Feel free to bring it into your home games. D&D Beyond makes it easy.
Oh, just then ignore that. I'll just do damage.
Okay, perfect.
And that is 14 damage.
Perfect. Your blade strikes true, slicing through. You see several of these like hornets fall to the ground, dead from your blade. As they fall off and the swarm attempts to sort of save itself, it's going to use its reaction to sort of like kind of create almost like this like parabola around you. Is that the right word?
Yeah.
And and forming this like perfectly like formate, they almost like form into like a grid in a in a perfect acoustic cone.
It's a nightmare.
Oh, no.
And all at once they just start buzzing.
Oh.
The sound is deafening. Make a DC 12 constitution check.
Let's go. Okay. You got this? You got this?
Hey, there
it's
it is.
It's a 19.
Yes.
You make it. You still take 6 psychic damage, but you are able to sort of, your ears are ringing, but you are not deafened this time. You're also able to resist the urge to run away.
Me, run. Would never happen. So these swarms, are they one creature?
Roll a nature check.
Let me tell you also why I'm asking. So with great weapon master attack, if I reduce a creature to 0 hit points with an attack, I can then make a melee weapon attack with a bonus action. So it's more whether that's going to be possible to, or whether what to pay attention to.
Yeah.
For that feat. You're saying to make a what?
A nature check.
Nature check. 15.
You get the sense that this is all one sentient creature, like a hive mind. Although it is technically different creatures, you get the sense that like watching them kind of die off and the ones that are left become emboldened, that they are driven by the same life force, essentially. They're driven by the same spirit and the same thought. These aren't creatures that are independent and kind of have come together under like some kind of brain control, but these are creatures that share some type of power or font of arcane energy.
Okay, and they're still around me?
Yes.
In a grid?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
They're kind of like facing you in like a cone-esque shape or that like acoustic booming space. Yeah.
All right, I'm going to action surge.
Perfect, yeah.
Ooh, I don't know if this will be effective, we'll see. You know, let's have some fun. I would like to use my extra action to create a wall of water around
Perfect.
Me.
Perfect. Mm-hmm.
in the exact shape of said bees, because it says I can make a ringed wall up to 20 feet in diameter, 20 feet high, and 1 foot thick. Mm-hmm. So, and the wall space becomes difficult terrain.
Perfect.
Essentially, that they are in. I'm trying to see if there's any sort of save they need to do, but I don't think there is. I think it just happens.
Yeah, their movement speed will just be reduced to half because they're traversing difficult terrain. They're trying to make their way through this wall of water.
Yeah, fire damage is halved. Ranged weapon attacks, a disadvantage. Spells that deal cold damage that pass through the wall freeze it solid. And then it has an AC and hit points.
Perfect.
Noted.
So I use that because I don't even want to be covered in bees.
So as this wall of water goes up, it is now the swarm's turn. All of the bees all at once kind of start, these hornets, I should say, start beating their wings together, like in perfect harmony, in unison. A wall of wind erupts from one swarm of bees, as well as the other one, kind of pinning you between the two. It's a line of strong wind, 60 feet long, 10 feet wide, and it blasts you, sort of to make it like if you draw a line between the two swarms and where mm-hmm. they intersect, like that should kind of let you know. So it's going to hit, not Merdina, because I think your water wall will save you, but it's going to hit Nicol and Cestia and kind of push you back towards the wall. Give me an acrobatics, or give me a strength saving throw.
Definitely good at that. Thank you for asking.
Mm-hmm. So 13.
12.
You both get pushed back 15 feet, slamming into the walls of the arena and taking 12 bludgeoning damage as you do so. The force is massive. You feel yourself pinned against this wall like it's a wind tunnel. Cestia, it's your turn.
Cool.
Go ahead and move yours. So Cestia would move in a straight line this way. Nicol would move in a straight line this way. Nicol was just barely out of range of the wall.
You hate to see it.
Both of them perfectly intersect where even if Merdina didn't have a water wall, they would have just passed behind her.
Incredible. So I'm looking at, I know that they're devil hornets, but I'm looking at bees and I'm a druid. Mm-hmm. I've read a book about this. Mm-hmm. They are a hive mind, but someone's making choices. Can I spot a decision maker? We don't have to use monarchy terms mm-hmm. like a queen, mm-hmm. but I want to see if I can spot, you know, the one making choices.
Yeah, give me a, I guess this would be an insight check or an animal handling check, I guess?
I would rather it be insight, but if you want it to be.
Let's do insight.
Cool,
insight makes
thank
a little
you.
More sense because this isn't an animal.
I've rolled so many threes on the dice. A nine.
Yeah, the buzzing of the sound, the way the entire arena is like kind of thrumming with energy. This isn't anything like any natural creature you've seen before. The only thing you're able to mark is that this is something of an arcane nature. There's powers here at work that are beyond just an insect. But you do get the sense that there is something bigger, kind of an invisible hand that drives the whole thing.
Okay, can't figure it out now. That's totally fine. I'm going to point to the bees kind of on my right that are closer. Mm-hmm. I would like to cast Call Lightning.
Perfect, yeah.
Look. So everything in a 10-foot radius, I'm just gonna center it, like center mass on it.
Perfect.
So I've got a 10-foot diameter, mm-hmm. just blast zone, a DC 14.
Amazing. Is that a dex save?
Yeah, you know. Bees, so dexterous. Did I say that right? Go look at your spell.
I got a 12.
Okay, cool. Thank you for rolling bad. Oh wait, sorry, quick question. Looking up, it's outside. We're in an outdoor auditorium,
yes.
right?
Mm-hmm.
What's the sky looking like right now?
It's a swirl of galaxies that you can see. There's like...
But like, there's nebulas I would say is maybe a storm.
Yeah, of course.
Are you gonna give me credit for that?
Yeah.
If there's a stormy condition thing for extra damage on Call Lightning, and I'm going to wheedle my way into trying to make that make sense. You do not have to give this to me, but it would be
yeah.
irresponsible of me to not try.
To not ask.
Yeah.
This one's a tough one.
You can say no to me and I will not feel any differently.
Scientifically.
There are storms in space.
And I'm looking at
there's
Google
radiation
says.
Storms and there's, go ahead and give me a bare d20 roll.
Hurtful.
On an even, a luck roll. On an even, it's yours. So. On an odd, it's mine.
Okay. Come on, even.
12!
It's yours. Yes, just today, you see actually like an aurora borealis type of thing as an electrical slash radiation storm permeates the sky above you.
Perfect. Ooh. And she reaches up and yeah, instead of like creating any sort of cloud, that storm just sort of starts to obscure all the galaxies and like mm-hmm. the stars begin to wink out. And from the center of like that last star that's still visible through the cloud cover is the bolt of lightning as I perfect. Roll and I have to add another d10 really quick. 24 points of
24
damage.
Points of damage. The swarm shudders as this lightning calls down on it. And as it shudders,
I feel like something worse is about to happen.
We see it split.
Probably not.
Again.
Amazing. Mm. With my bonus action then, the split that's closer to me, my starry form suddenly looks like an archer, and this like limb of stars, she like passes her hand through the sky, and it leaves a trail of little stars as I pull a bow and attack the
perfect.
Other swarm. For my bonus action.
The one on the left?
The one on the right.
Perfect.
Just the one that looks like it's going to touch me without passing through the problem that is Merdina.
Perfect, gotcha.
And that's an 18 to hit.
An 18 that hits.
Sweet. For 10 points of radiant damage.
Ooh. Perfect. Cool. Your arrow meets its mark. You see a flurry of exploding wings and carapaces as these hornets go flying and chunked into pieces. Then we see this swarm begin to move. It's going to, let me see. I feel like it's going to go for Merdina because they're the closest.
Mm. Mm-hmm. I am going to move and just slide a
little
bit this way if I can.
I think it's in the water wall
yeah.
right now.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It would still have the movement to like mm-hmm. make it there. This multitude of swarming winged little mini serial killers just attempts to attack you with all the ferocity it can muster. Hornet swarms are vicious, y'all. I rolled a 20 and an 8. Does a 12 hit?
No.
I think the 20 might hit, though.
The 20 does. Which one's first?
The 8.
I would love to riposte.
Okay, perfect.
And I will use the superiority die to attack. Mm-hmm. With my claymore.
I've been waiting for this moment.
To hit bees?
My entire life. Since I was a wee child. 22 to hit.
That hit?
Doing 15 damage.
That's perfect. As these hornets start like stinging you viciously, you slice through them with your claymore, kind of exposing your bare arm. Mm-hmm. A few of them meet their mark. As they do, you take 11 piercing damage from the second swarm. Mm-hmm. That's their crit damage. Make a constitution saving throw.
Okay. 14.
Ooh, one shy.
Yeah,
and this sucks because it's a crit.
Yeah.
So that's 11, 15.
Hold on. Quick question. Do reactions refresh on your turn?
Reaction. So. Oh, you're trying to give me a reaction? Because I just used my reaction.
Reactions reset on the player's turn. Yeah. So I have my reaction back.
Yeah.
Yes, you do have your reaction back.
Cool. May I use my reaction? Is it too late? If you want to let this happen, you're good. Yeah, you're good.
Normally I'd give it to you, but.
Your cash money, don't worry about it.
Been waiting my whole life for this moment.
Yeah.
Why? This moment's bad.
It strengthens my resolve.
Okay.
The poison that comes coursing through your veins is just, it it almost burns into your flesh. You feel like your veins are on fire, and as you look down at your arm, you can see them visible against your skin. This was a crit roll, so I feel like the poison damage is also a crit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
15 points of poison damage.
No, thank you.
It's toasty.
It gets worse.
Oh.
You feel a sense in your mind that you cannot take another blow like this, because before you recover from the first one, you get this sense that if you were to get stung again, your entire arm would be paralyzed.
Ooh.
This is me gently warning you.
Love it.
That right. If you take more poison damage after taking this amount of poison damage, you will be paralyzed and it will suck.
Cool. Fuck!
You are, however, poisoned this now, kind of giving you disadvantage.
Whoa.
Gotcha.
Okay, poisoned?
Mm-hmm. You gain the poison condition. You can make a constitution saving throw at the end of each of your turns to try to recover from the poison.
Dope. At the end of each round.
Oh, this is cool.
Yes.
I don't want it to happen to me, but it's cool that it's happening.
You all see Merdina, like, normally so stoic and brave. What is your state like now?
She's still trying to strike a pose, but it's...
The swarm finishes.
Now.
I feel like I look back at both of them.
It's no good.
The swarm finishes its vicious assault and kind of hovers in the air above you again. Pop, right next to you, you see...
Oh, no.
You see Harpy. It's like, oh, my gosh, that one looked like it hurt. Can we get a zoom in on that arm? Oh, my, it's puffy. It's horrible. You might die today. What's going through your head?
This heist, you know, I waited a long time to have the feeling of near death coursing through my veins and... It's not as good as they say it is, but I'm gonna make it out.
Personally, I don't think so, but we'll see. Nikhil, back to you, and it's your turn.
I'm going to rise up and go full Killmonger and go, are these your bugs? Are these your bugs? You like these bugs? And I'm gonna say, Merdina, my best friend! I will avenge you! And I'm gonna soar towards them. Mm-hmm. I'm going to bonus action cast Expeditious Retreat. I get fast. I got a bonus action dash.
Yeah.
And I'm gonna take two swings. These are the ones that I have my Hexblade's Curse on. So we're gonna go number one. That is a critical hit.
Yes!
What? Yes.
Yeah, because this one here, which is where you have the curse on. Perfect.
Yeah, when I have the curse on. So I'll go there. Let's resolve this one first. I'm gonna throw a second level smite onto this one. So that's gonna be 2d12 plus 6d8 plus 5.
Let's go.
Boom, boom. Let me go. D8's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Let's go.
So let's go real quick here.
These hornets are about to get fucked up.
That's a 55 damage.
Is that all?
This swarm is utterly obliterated by this massive critical hit. Yes. What does it look like as your lance just completely tears through them?
So I will also say here, that my, I love this game. I love this game, I really do.
Nerd.
So first of all, I immediately regain 6 hit points. So I think as I fly towards them, I go, hurrah! There's a lot of fire, but the lance is gold and it's dealing all radiant damage because I'm still a paladin. So it's, gah! And the tip of the lance goes into the middle of the swarm, creates a point of light that like a solar flare.
Yes.
It like lens flares and radiates light from this stabbing point in the center of the swarm for 55 points of damage. And I just sort of swallow a bunch of that light and regain those 6 hit points.
Oh,
long tongue, this tongue comes like all the way down. Ah, like bearing tusks.
I get why people make mistakes.
Roll persuasion or performance with advantage.
Oh my god.
Let's go.
Okay, here we go. Shit. Here we go. Boom, boom. This is going to be plus 5 to the roll here. It's going to be an 18 on a performance
Ooh.
Check.
Ooh. You hear like this like sort of solar flare goes out. the swarm is utterly decimated and it falls into like two smaller swarms. And then you hear it, slow at first, but the crowd chanting, Nick, kill, kill it. Nick, kill, kill it.
I'm gonna fucking cry.
Nick, kill.
Don't cry.
Kill it. Nick, kill.
You know kill it. I've been saying the boys are bad the whole time.
The swarm, which was previously kind of emboldened by the buzzing of the Colosseum, you see now a face form in the waxen tree trunk of the tree, and you see the swarm retreat into its mouth. You see now that the branches are kind of its hands, and that it was manipulating them, almost like a marionette.
We finna kill a tree?
Looks at you all. Like, you know, seeing that it's somehow lost favor, you know, it's these wax forms like looked like cracks, but then like open up and you realize there's a face there. And it looks at you all like this. And then it says, oh my God. Please don't kill any more of my hornets.
I think that's up to these fine people in the crowd tonight!
I yield.
Can't knock a good move. I had another attack.
Harpy reappears with a pop and is like, well, that was completely unexpected. Looks like our local folk legend is going to have to retreat in abject shame with no dignity whatsoever to your name. You know what? I was never much of a tree hugger anyway.
Harpy, you are a card.
And so are you. What a fabulous performance from you today, Nicole. You know what? In our polls, you actually weren't rating that very well, but I'm pleased to inform that your team as a whole has jumped up 10 points.
Good. Yeah. Yeah, that's right. That's absolutely right, Harpy.
So make sure you join us tomorrow for more battles in the Battle for Beyond. We look forward to seeing you in the Colosseum. Also, I'm pleased to announce, yes, as of tomorrow, we will now have foam lances with Nick Hill's branding on them available in the gift shop. Make sure you check them out for the low, low price of how many fragments of a soul?
What?
Is that the currency here?
Seven gold.
Gold.
And I'll be signing those lances outside in the parking lot. Thank you.
Nice.
You got to get your cut somehow.
Branding.
Yeah.
I want to walk over and I pat Nick Hill on the shoulder and I pat you on the shoulder. I'm casting Lesser Restoration to remove her poison condition.
Your hands are so healing.
I leave my hand on her shoulder.
Yeah, the spell requires me to hold on for just like 10 more seconds.
Her biceps ripple.
Yeah. Under your hands. Jesus. This is good for both of us. Okay, I'm gonna stop now. That was weird. Right. My hand's sweaty.
Feels good.
You good? You retreat to the hero's repose. Still holding each other. You hold her arm the whole way.
Yeah, just want to make sure it takes.
Yeah, right there.
Should I go?
No, stay.
Oh, awesome, actually. Yeah, I'll fully stay, yeah. If what's happened, what's about to happen? Do we know?
Please don't jinx it. I'm still in my starry form, like, I will kill you. The universe is unfeeling, and I will obliterate you if you ruin this for me.
All of this conversation, I just use my second wind to just... it's like a breath of fresh air being surrounded by you all to heal myself.
In my hand numb. Good job. You were so good telling everyone, like,
incredible.
Feel a way about our group. That was really good.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I'm not a clown. I'm really not.
No one said you were a clown. They said you were
a... Everyone I know says I'm a clown. A lecherous buffoon, right? That's what you heard?
Literally those words. Why that specifically?
I mean, I've not seen that from you. You've seen Jenin.
You guys, did you stay in the towns you grew up in, or did you go around?
Oceans, but not too far out besides the ocean and below.
If you never leave where you grew up, you're the person you were when you were a kid forever. I am terrifying, and people need to know that about me. And I'm not who I was when I was a kid. Great fighting with you. You were awesome. You were incredible. Holy smokes.
Thanks.
That star form, well, you should just be that.
Thanks, oh, I'm sorry. And kind of.
Why? This is great. No, I would be that all the time if I could.
Either.
It's weird. It kind of hurts. But, well, you like don't feel. Like, I don't feel anything.
Well, you didn't feel.
Like,
oh, hold on.
Pain?
No. And I'll flex again. And
no, I felt
know
that.
You didn't
that was,
feel anything.
I'm sorry. I don't
God,
know what
I don't
we're talking
know if
about
I should
anymore.
Go or if I should stay.
No, now
as
I
you
want you to stay
say
too.
That. As you say, like you gotta let me know if I should go or if I should say. What did you say?
I was like, no, I need you to stay too. I'm into it.
Oh yeah. As you're looking towards the door, you do see your sister kind of like lurking somewhere in the shadows outside.
Here's the deal. I think we are. It's possible that this is all just talk, or it's possible that we are moments away from fucking. And if I leave right now,
what's that?
Can we hear you? Can I roll to hear?
Oh wait, I'm speaking infernal.
Yeah. I don't think I speak that.
That's fair.
So I don't know. I'm super confused right now. I mean, I'm gonna let them do their thing. I'm gonna come out and talk to you. I'm gonna talk to you. Hey, great fighting out there. Great fighting out there. Most people would have gone down to even one of those. You made a stern stuff. I don't know what they're doing in the ocean, but it's working.
Aerobics.
For real?
I water aerobics.
Well, I would imagine, yeah. All right, well.
As you walk away, yes, Estia's gonna reach out and grab your hand. Thanks for fighting with us instead of like letting us die or whatever you were thinking. And I cast Cure Wounds.
I fully scream as you start to cast a spell on me. Ah! 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 Kill me! What are you doing?
Take back 13 points of healing as I just scream back at you.
My wounds, you sold them! What?
What? No, I don't have them. They're gone. You okay?
You just heal me?
Yeah. Because we're friends, right? I'm sorry, we're teammates. I'm sorry, did it hurt?
You're a jumpy bugger.
Good.
Watch out, he's gonna scream. Okay.
No, it's fine. Being hit and touched without saying it's okay is very normal for me. No one's ever done that.
Oh.
Nobody's ever done that.
I'm sorry.
No, it's good. No one's ever just seen me in pain and, you know. How are you doing? Are you okay?
Oh, and yeah, looking back at her corporeal form, she's like, oh, I'm kind of fucked up. I got this. Thank you.
I put a hand on you, and I'm going to lay on hands for whatever it means to get you to full.
Nice. Thank you. She took 12 points.
I'll throw 12 points at you, and I'll throw 13 points at you.
Oh. Zestia fully hugs you when you do that. She's just, I'm sorry. This is way scarier than I thought it was going to be, but it feels good that I have people on my side, so thank you.
It's better as a team. Always.
Yeah. Yeah. For as long as they, it's very you're both very good at what you do, for real. And thank you for that.
Yeah.
Sorry I screamed. I thought you were trying to kill me.
Do people try to kill you all the time?
More than they try to do whatever you just did, the healing.
Oh. That sounds bad.
Who were you when you were a child? I'm sorry.
Me still. What do you mean?
You hear like your sister's foot tapping impatiently outside.
Yeah, all right, I'm gonna go. You guys, whatever you do, if you want to just leave the door open or closed.
I like your top.
Thank you.
Turquoise looks really cool on you.
I appreciate that.
I like blue.
I like your everything. You were amazing out there.
Oh my God, you're amazing.
I'm sorry, I have to steal away my
No,
brother.
You're good, go ahead.
He's mine, so it's not really stealing, right?
I belong to myself.
Oh, come along.
Okay.
And she like kind of like ushers you out. And then, As you're like leaving, she says like, Nikhil, that was brilliant. You did everything right. I can't believe it. It's like we were waiting for this and then you were ready.
Yeah.
I think you were maybe getting stuffed peeling potatoes, maybe turning into a potato yourself, but now. You know, there are special rewards for people that excel in these games. And I'm sure your friends are lovely, but your loyalty should be to your family. And she presses a vial into your hand. you immediately recognize it as hornet venom. Just in case. Friend today is an enemy tomorrow.
Yeah.
And we can only trust blood.
I know those friends of mine are not my family. And I know where my loyalty lies.
She presses her forehead against yours.
Do the same.
I'm proud of you. There was a bit of showboating there for a minute. I feel like you oversold it, but you know, it really came around in the end because imagine if you had talked all that smack and then you had just flubbed it, you know? But I mean, it worked out.
I know, no one's ever had faith in me, but I did it.
Well, based off that performance, I might have to change my tune.
Yeah. Thanks for the hornet venom, sister, and I'm glad that, I finally had a shot to prove what's really going on to everybody.
I feel like this is only the beginning of your journey.
I believe that too.
And that'll be where we call today's session to a close. We'll see you next time in the battle for Beyond.
Yay!
Did Merdina and Cestia smash?
Here at the edge of the universe, realities aren't the only thing that collide.
I'm gonna slap McKill.
Get out of here! I'm out of spell slots, baby. That just felt good.
Well, we're not babies anyway, so you couldn't babysit for us because we're grown-ups.
You're so pretty.
How do you say snitches get stitches?
I got you. No fucking snitching, okay?
Who can I stab and when?
Are you all in the same bed or not? Because I gotta know.
Look, I would like to paint a word picture.
You just see Econ crumble.
Oh no!